home is bright and fair, I feel like traveling on. Nor pain nor death can enter there, I feel like traveling on. Yes, I feel like traveling,
Lord, to rest. Give us the strength, Lord, to rise and dress ourselves and move about here upon this earthly footstool. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us to be in this little service here tonight with your brothers and sisters. And Lord, we ask you to look down upon us, Lord, with your grace and mercy. And Lord, pray that whatsoever is said and done here tonight will be according to your will, dear Lord and Father, to be for your praise, your glory, and the honor, and the uplifting of building your kingdom here upon this earthly footstool. Those that are gathered here tonight, Lord, that be one that don't know you, the pardon remission of sin, they might hear the very words, Lord, that they stand in need of to come to you. And your children, Lord, that's gathered, pray that they be strengthened, Lord, by your word, the food that feeds our souls, Lord, here upon this earthly footstool. Go with us, Lord, on down through this service, on down through this life. Watch over, lead, guide, and direct us, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name, and amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let me live, blessed Lord, in the light of thy word. Let my life be a light. death's bondage,
but deliverance came to me.
Let me walk, blessed Lord, in the way thou hast gone, leading straight to the land above, giving cheer everywhere to the sad and the lone. Fill my way every day with love. Fill my way. As I walk with the heavenly dove.
never in darkness roam. Keep my path free from wrath and my soul satisfied. Fill my way every day.
By the grace of God, I'm free.
With the
another one while we get this next one. Everybody can move around, fellowship. We'll be going into prayer in a little bit.
When I was
drifting
out in sin, I had no peace.
I had no peace,
no joy within,
no joy within.
But Jesus came.
To be said about that. Who is his friend? When you think about Abraham was considered that. Some of the other old patriarchs of old, a friend of God. I find if we'll be obedient to him and do what he's told us to do, we're a friend of his.
That's right.
And he still loves us, even though we might not be doing what we're supposed to. That love is still there. But
That love on the day of judgment will be turned to wrath if we're continuing in disobedience. So, and then we'll still go to hell with that love. He'll still love us. Mm-hmm. He's given us the opportunity to get out of that condition. So there's nothing can separate us from that love. And I'm thankful for that. So it's up to us. Again, going back to what we heard here last weekend, it's an individual matter between us and God. Absolutely. Where we're going to go when this life is over. Good to see all of you tonight. Getting ready to go to prayer. If you got an unspoken request, I'd like to have an interest in this prayer. God bless. A lot of sickness going around, a lot of people down.
There was a woman in the Bible days who had been sick so very long. And she heard that Jesus was passing through, so she joined the gathering throng. While she was pushing her way through, someone asked her, "What are you trying to do?" She said, "If I could touch the hem of his garment, I know I'd be made whole right now."
Yeah.
And she stood there crying, "Oh Lord, oh Lord, oh Lord." She said, "If I could touch the hem of his garment, I know I'd be made whole right now."
Yeah.
She spent her money here and there, but she had no more despair. The doctors, they did all that they could, but their medicine would do no good. When she touched him, the Savior didn't see, but still he turned around and cried, "Somebody touched me." She said, "It was I just want to touch the hem of your garment. I know I'll be made whole right now." And she stood there crying, "Oh Lord, oh Lord, oh Lord." She said, "If I could touch the hem of his garment, I know I'd be made whole right now."
You know, Sister Rita mentioned a while ago of her blessing, and it's grace. It's grace.
Yeah.
It is. It really is. In Romans 8 talks about that, getting having access to it. But when she said that, I thought, an old song, I don't know how much of it I can sing, it's Amazing Grace, but I wanted to line it a little bit. And I sang it one time up at our church, and Josie said, "You need to slow that down." I said, "Well, honey, if I slowed it down and sang all 8 verses, it'd take us 45 minutes to get through." So, and Manuel's sister, she lives down in North Carolina, she come up and she said, "George, why don't you sing us a song, something besides all of Amazing Grace?" I said, "Okay." But it's the songs that we sing, we want to have a direct relationship with the Scripture.
Right.
Yeah, that makes a spiritual song.
That's
that.
Right.
It makes it mean something to us.
Yeah.
When we can like that, or even to a certain incident in our life, people say, just like this Amazing Grace, John Newton was supposed to have been a slave trader or something and got converted. And then you think, well, I call it the Baptist anthem, and how good, what a good song it is for people. It fits any occasion. It'll fit a funeral or a wedding when you want to sing it. It's all because it's all about his grace. And that's what makes it an ending, non-ending song, because when we're all gone, if the church is still here, there'll be somebody singing Amazing Grace, and they'll sing it with emotion in their heart because they can think back on what God's done for the Christian people.
Yeah.
I'm just like you. I can't begin to even start on what the Master's done for me this year. Been to church 40 years, and I can't begin to see the times four or five of the elders gather around a sick person, go visit a brother and sister in the hospital. Didn't look good at all for them, see them come back out. Now, that's grace. I think it is. It's grace. It is what He grants us, the very desires of our heart, if they're in tune, like you mentioned there a minute ago. If our desires are in tune with the Master,
yeah,
it's good. It's the only life. I don't know no other life other than being a Christian. Because I'm a new creature now. I'm not what I was 40 years ago. He don't even come up anymore like he used to, that old man. Things. I know sometimes a flashback will come. I'll turn kind of red and drop my head. So I can't believe I done something like that. Get gas out of people's cars and stuff like that just to be getting it, you know. But that's the way God works. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed, the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. I have already come. 'Tis grace that brought me safe thus far. 'Twas grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home, and grace will lead me home. Well, when we've been there 10,000 years, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise. We've no less day to sing God's praise than when we first begun, than when we first begun. I think about the poor people throughout our land and country and the Christian people. I think they call around here some like the Bible Belt. And to think about where it all started at in that country over there, the born again salvation that's practiced as Christ intended it to be has migrated into our country over here. And I have no doubt in my mind that in this Bible Belt that there is people here that's been praying for our country to exist as it is in the freedom that we can still go. I've heard brethren talk in the pulpit about afraid the time will come where we won't have a place of worship.
Yeah.
I disagree with that. I think as long as we're here, he'll find a sanctuary for his fire.
I really do.
I feel that now. And I wouldn't say that to contradict some of the old elders preaching and God for nothing. I wouldn't want to fuzz one of them at that. But I believe that he's got a bride that's dressed that he is so proud of that we'll have a place for him. Tony, I believe that. It's not through pride and arrogance to be puffed up about it. But I think he loves his church good enough, the poor people.
Yeah.
They've been enslaved out of hole and corner working an old double tree plow sock out in these fields.
It's going to go on.
Man told my daddy right there, I remember this, I'm just a little fella, and you may remember Brother Wallace Williams used to go over there. Told daddy said, I was born on July the 12th, 1917. That's what an impact it made on me. And he grinned and chewed his back like that and said, Harris, what did you say? He said, July the 12th, 1917. Tears started coming down his eyes, July the 12th, 1917. At the end of that old field back there, they had a chestnut stump. He said, I got saved there plowing the mule, but tougher than I was.
Yeah.
But I got saved on that hill. You know if that means something. When you've got that born again experience with God and it will carry you, it is directing the very footsteps that you follow. That's a life that our Lord wants us to share. And I don't think he would ever do nothing to a man that's walking after and pleased to be walking and happy in the vine where you're abiding to go ahead and walk it all a good long life. I don't think he wants that damn to be it, and I think he'll help us. He'll help us walk when we can't even walk by ourselves. When we can't even pray, he'll give you an utterance of a groan or something to glorify his majesty on high. And gratitude and mercy for his son. And how much that son appreciated down here in our heart and what he's done for the little gathering here like at Salem Church tonight. You want to see something big? You watch people try to overthrow the church. It ain't going to happen. It's too solid to rock his field on. Cost too much from the pride of heaven to even just turn his back and walk off from them that love and cherish and care for him. And I've got to be God.
Yeah.
And I sure wouldn't want to lock horns with him and try to get on his mean side when I'm this rod of his chastisement. I suffered that, boys, and it's painful. But I've been a better man after the chastisement of God. I've been a stronger man, brother, in the office. I've been more steadfast. That's the reason I like to get out and go.
Yeah.
And because I had Brother Mangle mentioned one time, he said, I like fellowship. I like to shake hands with people and get a degree of fellowship, Brother Jeff. Maybe to rub off on us a little bit, maybe someday, to hug a brother or sister's neck and wish them well. I love him because he first loved me. He died for me, and the least I can do is live for him.
I
love
the Lord. Yes.
I thank you, Brother Tony.
Praise
the
Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I feel so free here.
Praise the Lord.
Do you all feel free in the spirit of the Lord? Yeah. That's why he comes. That's why he's visiting us. He's free. He told us one place, I said, I stand at the door and knock. And I don't know how long he knocks. I don't know what it would take to make him quit. But if you open up your heart, he'll come in and suck with
you. That's right, man.
And that's a great joy in my heart. I can't get this watching television to have.
That's right.
Got a satellite, probably got 20 or 30 Christian networks on it. But you can't get this there. Them preachers can't tell me how to worship God, because I've learned through being born again, Brother Tim, that He is what He is, and He is my Lord. And He guides me, Brother Dolphus, and He guides me in the right way. Sure, sometimes I step out of line, but then God gets right here, you kind of feel your heart squeeze a little bit. It don't take long to put me back in line, but Lord, I've learned patience. And I learned through tribulation, when He starts to deal with my heart, be getting ready to pull off from her, say, well, I'll go on to the house. And then you feel your heart squeeze. You see the old Ford stub up in the back, and I'll turn around and go back and see that fella.
Yep.
You'll grow if you obey.
Yeah, that's right. You will.
Paul told us to obey from the heart.
That's right.
Not us standing there with a big whip or a big sword fixing to shut me off. But one day it'll be His good pleasure, by His amazing grace, to welcome me into that place. And I'm going to go there.
Amen.
Just a poor old gristleback coal miner, but I'm going to have the most sought after thing. It's gold. Men's died for it. Come, Jesus has been overturned for it. But I prayed to be a forecoming to this brother.
Yeah, welcome.
Praise the Lord.
You think of that. Think what He's promised us, Brother Joe.
Amen.
Makes me want to go.
Yeah, yeah.
And He said it could.
Yeah. Amen, brother.
Bless your name. Thank you. Thank you, Brother Tony, for your patience with me.
Glad to have you.
With things of this is on my soul, unto the Lord I cried, till Jesus came and made me whole. I would not be denied.
Think about it.
Satan said my Lord was gone and would not hear my prayer. But praise the Lord, the work is done and Christ the Lord is here.
I'd ask for your prayers, and I ask you all to help me. God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus.
Amen.
He came to love, heal, and forgive. He came and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just. because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because he lives, because he lives, I can face tomorrow, because he lives. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll face life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory. I'll know he reigns, because he lives, I can face tomorrow, because he lives, all fear is gone, because I know life is worth the living just because he lives.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
He's our all in all.
Beautiful song.
Brother Jordan. Because he come back and he went to that cruel cross and he rose again. Brother Bruce.
Amen.
Because he lives, we can live again.
That's right. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Anybody else?
You're singing that song? That song is bad.
I think we're trying to go on her.
Enjoying these songs, the words, the message, lifts our minds, brother. Old cares and troubles of this life. They'll be right out there when we go back out, but we can enjoy a few moments of peace. Like
yeah.
The Lord told us that in the world you'll have tribulations, but in me you'll have peace. That's it's there all the time. I mean, even in the tribulations. I'm a pilgrim on a journey, headed for a better land. When the way gets rough and the trial's so hard to understand, I call the one that started with me, said he'd be there till the end. And when I need strength, he's blessing me again. But it's so hard to comprehend that he takes thought of men. When the stars they shine and the sun rises, all at his command. I'm just a small, small grain of sand,
in the wonders of his hand. But now he's blessing me again. Now I've not always been the best man for the Lord that I could be. I stumbled, yes, and sometimes I have given in. But my Lord, he's great in mercy, and the moment I repent, I find he's blessing me again.
Yeah.
But it's so hard to comprehend that he takes thought of men. When the stars they shine and the sun rises, all at his command. I'm just a small grain of sand in the wonders of his hand. But now he's blessing me again. It's so hard to comprehend that he takes thought of man. When the stars they shine and the sun rises, all at his command. I'm just a small grain of sand in the wonders of his hand. But now he's blessing me again. Thank God he's blessing me
yeah.
again.
Yeah. Oh, Lord.
We think what he told Abraham, Father Abraham. You count the stars, the sands of the seashore, so shall thy seed be. That's what we are, just little grains of sand here upon this earth. Yet he is mindful of us. He's mindful. He takes thought of us, Brother Junior. Here, he loved us in so much that he sent his only begotten Son to die for our sins and our transgressions. It's beyond our imagination, our minds that we can comprehend the love that God has for us here in this way. This carnal mind just can't understand it. But the Spirit that's down in our life, it relates. It lets us know. Brother George spoke a while ago about the times that we can't even think to pray, what to pray. But it says that the Spirit makes intercessions with us, or for us with moanings and groanings that cannot be uttered. Brother George, that little Spirit down in our life, even when we don't even know what to ask for, when we don't know how to talk to God, the little Spirit makes intercession for us through moanings and groanings that we can't even understand, that we can't find words to speak here in this way. It's so marvelous in our eyes. This is the most precious thing that we could ever obtain here upon this earth, God's footstool. If we live 1,000 years and obtain this whole world, what would a man give in exchange? It's beyond our imagination. But I thought when I heard that song, how it's we're just little small grains of sand in the wonders of his hand, that he can take such a creature as us and use us a little bit here for his glory. And that's what we was put here for, Brother George, that we might give him glory at what time that we live here upon this earth, God's footstool. And look at this world, how it's just completely forgot about God here in this way. And that you spoke about that gold, that the love of money is the root of all evil. That's what's ruling this world out here. That's why the brother spoke about, you just don't understand why people ain't coming. They got too much here in this life. There's too much riches, too much wealth here, and they're putting all their trust in it, Brother Bruce. And it's blinding their minds. Satan is blinding their minds with the things of this world that they can't see the light of the glorious gospel or the kingdom of God here upon this earth, and they're falling into the darkness of this world, stumbling along in this darkness, headed for a place that's called hell, Brother Bruce, when this life's over, and don't even realize what they're doing, Brother George. But God speaks to their heart, but they just push it aside here in this way because of the things of this world, that so much wealth, so much prosperity in this world that people has here in this way, that they don't have time for God. The old people back a few years ago, they didn't have all this stuff. They thought more about God. They was thankful for everything that they had, Brother Bruce. The food that was put on their table, the clothes, the roof over their head. Now people's got so much, they just keep piling it up and piling it up and piling it up, and it's covering them up here in this way. And they're choking out God out of their lives here in this way, and out of their minds. That's what Satan's doing to our people here in this way, and it's getting worse every day. Evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. It don't say this world's going to wax worse and worse. It says evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse, deceiving, being deceived their own self. God bless you. Real good place to be already. I go home satisfied. You know, sometimes we go to the church, and whether it be us or somebody else or something other going on, you don't go away from the church being fed, don't seem like, Brother Tony, but then sometimes you get to come to church, you get fed. So it's one of them times that we feel good. We go home satisfied, and we thank God for that.
Into the garden the Savior had went, in pain and in sorrow all night he had spent. Down on his knees to the Father he prayed, then on Calvary's mountain the sin debt he paid. Down through Jerusalem street he was led, stripes on his back, thorns on his head. The pure Lamb of God who never knew sin, filling the place where I should have been, and bearing the cross that we all had made. Upon Calvary's mountain the sin debt he paid. As he hung on the cross, the blood flowing down, forsaken by loved ones, his friends not around. Father, forgive them, they all heard him say. Then he cried, "It is finished. The sin debt is paid." Down through Jerusalem street he was led, stripes on his back, thorns on his head. The pure Lamb of God who never knew sin, filling the place where I should have been, and bearing the cross that we all had made. Upon Calvary's mountain the sin debt he paid. Down through Jerusalem
Jerusalem street he was led. Stripes on his back, thorns on his head. The pure Lamb of God, who never knew sin, filling the place where I should have been, and bearing the cross that we all had made. Upon Calvary's mountain, the sin debt he paid. Upon Calvary's mountain, the sin debt he paid.
Paid in full, Brother George, is the scriptures. You can, it don't say paid in full that way, but you read in there and you get dig right down into it, Brother Bruce. It was all paid for on Calvary.
Amen.
Every sin that's ever been committed. It ain't sin that's going to cause people to go to hell. It's unbelief. They don't believe that there was a Savior come, Brother Tony, and died for them. And a while ago when I was talking about, you know, don't know what's keeping them out there. I know for a little wide majority, we know it's sin. They love darkness rather than light. But what I'm talking about on an individual basis, everybody's different. It may be some little tiny something other in their way. I don't know what that is, but God does.
Absolutely.
And we can pray in one accord together and say, Lord, I don't know what it is in their way. But just remove it. Show them what it is. It ain't worth, Brother Bill, hanging on to. We're concerned about our people.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, Brother Tony, we see people coming. I'm glad they do.
Yeah.
Last week we've got two or three that comes quite often, more than some Christian men and women.
Yeah.
And they'll sit right there and they'll hear the gospel over and over and over. And then knowing the Spirit is moving strongly, I don't see how they stand it. That's what I'm talking about.
Yes.
There's something wrong. There's something in the way. And they love darkness rather than light. That's the majority, Brother James. It covers it all. But it might be just some little something or other in the life that they've had, that the devil has got a hold of and twisted it so deep down in their flesh that they think that they can't get rid of that. They can't believe that Jesus has done more for it. Done some cure of it, moved it out of the way, and all they have to do is say, Lord, here I am. I can't do a thing with it. I've went as far as I can go with it. Don't know what else to do. That's where I was at 2 years ago.
Yeah.
And you know what, Brother Dolphus, when I got to that point, I dropped my head over on the seat crying. I began to weep with a broken and contrite spirit. And when did I done that, God come into my life.
Amen.
And let me know I've taken cure of it. Just move out. Do what I said to do. Well, we heard some gospel the other night up there. I'm telling you, I enjoyed that tremendously. You know why? I believe we heard it. I believe there were several fellers and women that was there said, Lord, there's some lost people here we love, and you love them better than we do, and you know what's in their way.
Yeah.
And, oh, God, would you just bless this brother when he comes? I know that he said it's your word. That's what we're supposed to do. But bring it to him so clear and so decisive to the person that needs to hear it that they'll move out. He tickled me to death with a tongue because everybody else did wrong.
Yeah.
Because God answered my prayer there. He answered for us too, Brother Bruce.
Yeah.
He's a prayer answer when we get together. He said, we're two gathered together in my name. Whatever they ask for, it shall be given. That ain't a Cadillac. That's a saving somebody's soul. That's also blessing of people that's in the church. I think it's a little closer to what God would have them to do. Think about that. How good that is. I didn't mean to do this, Brother Tony. It seemed like I'm getting awful bad to do that anymore. But listen, when we sing those songs, as I, like the brother said, it makes us feel good. It puts us in the right frame of mind and heart to know what a gift, Brother James, that we've got down here that comes from heaven's country. Made a little more than the angels for the suffering of death.
Made us free.
Think about it. Didn't have no sin whatsoever in him. But he bore it every drop. Everything that I know that I've done, Brother Tony, he's done it. He's done more. In the things I don't even realize, Brother Jeff, that I've done in my life because of ignorance, he's done more at all. And for you too, brother. We're serving a good God, ain't we? I was thinking about some of the scriptures. All right, if I read a little bit, sure, something comes to my mind. I want to get this just right. Been studying about some of these things. Isaiah. I mentioned a few things up there Echo the other night about old Isaiah. He comes to my mind quite often, the things that God blessed him to say, if I can find it here.
53rd chapter. Who hath believed our report? What's he talking about? He's talking about himself being directed of God to write down and to preach to them people at that time. Well, that same question that's asked right now. Right out there. Who hath believed our report? What are we reporting on? We're reporting about the good news from a far country. This is before it come, and he was telling people it's going to come. And salvation is going to be opened up unto the believers. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Who's that arm? His name is Jesus. Think about that.
Yep.
For he shall grow up before him. Before who? Before God, right in his presence. Talking about Jesus. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant. That's what we was preaching about here a while back, Brother Dolphus, about him being born of a virgin, a little child. And she began to kiss the face of God. Think about it. This is real. Little plant. And as a dry root, or as a root out of the dry ground. We're talking about that he was in a natural fleshly body, dry ground, but it had life in it, and it was eternal. And that's how he could bear our sins upon the cross, because he had no sin in him, no death in him, no guile in his mouth. He was a perfect Lamb of God that could bear everybody's sin at his choice. He didn't have to do that, Dale, but he done it for me, and he done it for you. And as a root out of dry ground, he had no form. Think about what that says. He hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him. What he, that's a for sure thing. He said, and when we shall see. Who's he talking about? My people. That goes on. We shall see him. There is no beauty that we should desire him. What's that talking about there? He said, he hath no form. That meant that he come not to present this creature. But he become a creature that had no sin in him. That he pursued God in front of everybody. And that meant that everything that he done the will of the Father. And he presented Father instead of himself. He had no form. He didn't present himself. What's that teach us, Brother Dale? We better be presenting Jesus in our life instead of a creature. Amen. Sticking our chest out and saying, boy, I'm something. We ain't nothing. The scripture well said we're less than nothing, Brother Tommy. Yeah. How good that this is. Think about it. Comeliness. He's talking about another word for that is a pleasant to look upon. Well dressed. A pretty to look upon. Nice, you know, looking. Well, it goes right on down. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty. Just plainer in that. He wouldn't present nothing pretty on the outside. But when people began to hear what he had to say, sis, they saw the beauty of God in him. Amen. Emmanuel, God in the flesh. Have I not been with you all this time? Have I not presented God? If you know me, you know God. If you've seen me, you've seen God. He wasn't talking about flesh, Brother Tommy. He was talking about the very works that he was doing, the very word that he was speaking. He was presenting God all the time. He is despised and rejected of men. Think about that. What happened to him? What? Listen, they cracked a whip on him and split him wide open until the bones was showing. More than any man. That's what it said in 52 there. His vestige was so full. Marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of man. Why? Because he looked down through the time and saw us, a needy people, that we needed the Lord. Ain't this good to refresh Christian men's minds on it? Why are we here this evening? To give him praise and glory and honor. To lift him up. Don't know if there's a lost person in the house. It don't matter. But these things, when it comes to our mind, it refreshes us and lets us know where we stand here. And it's strength and power to us. And to those that's on the outside, they can hear it and they can believe and be a part of this too. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief. And we hid as it were our faces from him. There's a lot of them done that, looked at him, you know, and hid their face. Hey, some of them looked at him when he was on the cross, wagged their head. Look what a mess. Well, if he be the Son of God, well, he cast himself down from there. Mocking. The God of heaven that was made a little lower than the angels. Think about that.
He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Why does he keep saying we? He put himself right where I am. A lost man needing a Savior. At one time in our life, we didn't recognize him as being the Holy Son of God. And we heard about the good story from a far country. But we didn't take it, sis, right down in our life where we live. But when the time come about, that this right here was presented right into our heart and mind. I said, this is real. Don't care what the world thinks about it, go move out on it. And he was right there ready for me. And he'll be right there for the next one. And when we get a little cold or kind of withdrawn because there's things and troubles in our life around us, let's put our mind upon what the Lord come here for. And it's not over with here. Even though we're going back to the dust in which we came, we're going to have a glorified body likened unto this one right here that he's talking about. That rose from the dead. Surely. I like him surely's. He hath borne our griefs. That means all my griefs, is it? He's already bore it. I need to remind myself of that. Satan say, oh, you're in a peck of trouble. Your body wearing out, feel bad. Oh, just stay home. Don't go to church. Yeah. Well, you've got a good excuse.
Oh, yeah.
But listen, it said, surely he hath borne our grief. When we read and study about this, we say, he done it all for me. The least I can do is push ahead for a little bit. I'm just going to be here for a little while upon the earth. I may be dead tomorrow, but tonight I'm going to praise God of heaven through his Son Jesus. Think about it. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Hey, well, my little wife was a dying, had my little hand on her heart. Last little beat there, last breath went out of her. Broken hearted. He was right there. Yep. Hey, I couldn't see him with my natural eyes, but I know he was right there. And he said, he carried our sorrows. Yeah, listen, that's all of us, even Isaiah. And listen, what? Yeah, we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God. Well, he was for our benefit. But you know what I think he means by that? It works the same way. This is the nature of this carnality of the person. Oh, what has that person done? They so much trouble in their life.
Yeah.
What in the world have they done? Look at them looking at Jesus. Now, I'm telling you, if God would be with him, he wouldn't be suffering these things that he's suffering.
Yeah.
That's this carnality. If you read all the scriptures, yeah, sometimes in a man's life or a woman's life, Brother Dale, that's probably true, but God only knows. We don't. Because you can get over in the old scripture there, and it says by chance that some of these things come up on a person. Being at the wrong place at the wrong time. I told my son the other day, he was talking about some of these things. Enjoy it. And my brother Terry come down, we got started. No, I went up to his house. I'm sorry. Got started on the same thing. Boys, I just move about talking about the same thing over and over. I said, listen, it's this simple. Somebody got a little gob of plutonium about that big, sets it down on the table. And I'm curious, George, brother, I've always been that way. Jeff, we're that way. We want to know how things work, don't we? We walk over to him and say, what in the world? Why, my goodness, that's plutonium. Well, it's too late. Yep. By chance, I was there over 30 seconds. Guess what? Yep. There's enough of those molecules entered into this body. I'm going to die. By chance. That's pretty simple, ain't it? So bad things happen to bad people, don't they? Because ain't none of us good. I remember the brother preaching that here one night. I enjoyed that. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. Think about that. What is that iniquities? It's worse than sin. You know, when you look it up, Brother Tony, in a regular college dictionary, Webster dictionary, it'll say iniquity is sin. You look up sin and say iniquity. It's not the same thing, brother. Listen, you get in the Bible and find out about what it's talking about. When God said that last day comes around, when he faced, and people's already judged, Brother Bill, we're being judged daily. As the tree goes down, so shall it be. If it goes to the north or south, so shall it be. If it goes down a sinner, so shall it be. If it goes down a righteous man or woman, so shall it be. That's what it's talking about. What is iniquity? Depart from me, thou worker of iniquity, I never knew you. He didn't say one time, depart from me, thou worker of sin. I never knew you. Sin's been bought and paid for. Think about it. Where's one of the places that you can first find out what iniquity is? As John Squinton used to say, old Booker man. That's the reason why he was out of favor with God, because iniquity was found in him. He was a perfect creation of God. Beautiful. Wonder why the Lord come not present himself beautiful. He didn't want to repeat Satan, did he? Huh? Did he want people to follow him because of what he had to say, or that he was pretty to look at? What's the world doing right now? Eyeballing those pretty things, ain't he? Hey, if we ain't careful, we'll be finding ourselves doing the same thing. Hey, we're a creature. We're made subject to vanity. That means if we had a king and his name was vanity, we'd bow the knee down to it. But the same was subjected in hope. And that same, I read in the scriptures, this is a scary thought, but I'm telling you, I've read in our study, a tenth, several places, and it kind of looks that way, a remnant, we're a remnant seed. And one place is talking about a tenth would serve him. That's a small amount, Brother Tony, compared to 9/10, ain't it? Wasn't they 10 lepers, and one of them was healed, and one come back and worshiped him? What are the other 9? Think about what he's talked about. We're few chosen vessels that he's put in his church and his places, Brother Dolphus, where it pleases him. Amen. And if we don't kick out of the riggins and we'll follow what he's told us to do, he'll be pleased with us, whatever it is, whether it's small or whether it's grand in this life. But he can take small things and he can make them grand if we'll do what he said to do. Think about how good that is. Iniquity. You know what another writer said? Didn't mean to get this much on my mind, Brother Tony. Another writer over there. Old man exalted himself. Over the book of Daniel. God knew he was going to do it. He sent a warning to it. Now if you stay right where you're at, old Nebuchadnezzar, he'll be well with you. But he knew he wasn't going to, and he told him. He said, what you need to do is leave off sin by doing righteousness. That's how you leave off sin, man. You do righteousness. What is righteousness? It's the word of God, his faith believing in it, and doing what God says for us to do. And he will accept this. He'll call us righteous because we've accepted his son and that blood that covers all of our sin. And in his eyes, as you said before, we're white as snow. Think about that. Break off iniquity by showing mercy to the poor. Oh my goodness. Now let's look at Satan for a minute. Did he not have all of us bound up in sin and sorrow and death and would not let the captives go free? Where was his compassion towards the poor? Did he have any? Has he got any now?
No.
That's what iniquity means.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you, brother, if we're in iniquity, guess who our king is? Guess who our king is if we're in iniquity when he comes back? That's why he said that. Because it's in Satan and it was found in him. And if we're following Satan and his ways, not having compassion towards God's people, iniquity will be found in us and he's going to turn us away too.
Amen.
But sin's been bought and paid for. That's about as plain as man can get it. I love the Lord this evening. How about you, Mom?
Amen.
Come on, go ahead, don't you?
Amen.
I was thinking about out there, Paul's chapel. Ask the Lord, Lord, why do you want me to study? No devil will come to you, well, that's down the way, son. Hey, you're dealing with a simple-minded old fellow here. God has to start pre-programming me and what he might want me to speak, because I don't get this real good. I study something or other and get it word for word sometimes, and I'm telling you, months from now, I couldn't tell you nothing about it. But that's me. And God placed me where I am for a purpose. Just like he has everybody else.
Amen.
So when I ask God, what do you want me to be a studying about, Lord? And he puts something on my mind, I get to study it. And I ain't getting into it the best that I know how. I want to be able to present the truth to God's people in ways where they can see and exactly know and understand what they need to do. And when Brother Jamie started preaching about that over there, that old eunuch, I said, glory, think about that, what I studied about. Not the eunuch, but what's being preached to him. That's a sermon. Wonder what caused the old eunuch to turn it over reading. I say, wonder what caused it. You think old devil was showing him that? No. Power of God from on high. Hey, while he was working with hints and read that. Get it on your mind. Get your study about it. What's that mean, Lord? I'll send you a fellow in a few minutes to tell you exactly what it means. That's the way God works. But there's preparation made. Wonder how long it was made in preparation before that. We don't know. God does. Wonder how long that fellow Philip had been traveling. Well, God could pick him up and send him down over there. I heard one brother say, he could pick him up and say, oh, well, he don't say that. That's all right with me. But sometimes we got to make preparation, got to travel. Look at little Mary. As the crow flies, she made journey upon journey. One time when she was pregnant just enough to show. One time she was so big she was in pains and sorrows, ready to be delivered. Had to on that journey, didn't she? By the power and authority of God. Yeah. 70 miles as a crow flies. I think somebody kind of figured it out. Hey, get on this Google Maps and stuff. 90 miles flat. Boy, it's like West Virginia, boys. How long is this curve going to go on? Am I going to end up in the same place I started? But as the crow flies on the map, 70 miles. Now you think about over at Treacherous. Hey, they didn't have white top roads in, brother. Her being pregnant, God wasn't going to let her have that baby outside that time in Judea. He said where she's going to have it, and that's exactly where she had it. Was it in a mansion? Did he want it to be born in a mansion? He come lowly and humble for us unto the poor. We're all poor and needy, but the rich think they're not. But us that are poor and needy, we know we're poor and needy. And I'm telling you that we accepted the Lord a few years ago because we know we're poor and needy. How hard it is to convince a rich man to turn from his ways and receive the things of God.
But it's not impossible with God, is it?
No, no, no.
But how hard, he asked the question, how hard is it? Well, ain't nobody else in this whole house here can do it except God. Who can be saved? One of them old boys said one time too. With man, it's impossible. But with God, all things are possible. Brother James, he knows what we need. Whether that we're rich or poor, as far as the things of this world, the carnality of these things that people desire. And he knows how to get it out of our way. That's one of the reasons why I say, I don't know what's in the way, Brother Tommy. And we don't. Sometimes, you know, took this from Brother Roger years ago. What's that Roger man? He followed him outside and talked to him for half an hour in the church. Hey, what was he doing? I stood beside him and listened to him about years ago. How you finding out what's in the wrong in a way? Not saying, looking at him and saying, hey, what in the world's wrong with you, son? What's in your way? But being, as we might say, sneaky about it. With love. Try to find out. Certain of is that part of our work? Not to be ignorant. To try to understand people. Everybody's different.
Yes, they are.
To try to reach them. The best we know how.
Amen.
I find myself being short in that. You know why? I feel like I'm intruding. That's my nature. God knows that. But you know what God tells me sometimes? Intrude. Is it better to intrude or stand back and let them die go ahead?
Intrude a little bit.
I want to intrude a little bit, Brother Dawkins.
Every day, every day.
Not me, but just with love and kindness, you know. Is there anything that I can do for you? You want to talk about something anytime you want to talk, call me.
Yeah.
Hey, we'll sit here and talk till midnight if you want to.
Yeah.
I've told them that a few times. God is pleased with those things. I mean, now think about this, Brother Tommy. I've been a sack. The Lord, while he was here, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, People, most of them didn't know that. He's always been that. It was revealed to a few of us that he is King of Kings, Lord of Lords, from generation to generation. But him being King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the Son of the living God, made flesh, walking with men and women that needed help, and would talk one-on-one to them. One-on-one. Many times, one-on-one. Little Gentile woman. One-on-one. Think about it. Are we not to be Christ-like, Brother Jeff?
Amen.
Sometimes we talk to a crowd. That's what he's doing with us. And sometimes we talk one-on-one. We've had church services up there. Probably will. Up Brush Creek on a business meeting tonight, tomorrow night, three or four of us. I'll look back to him and say, Brother Country, we always spoke that. It's just in our mind. We'd like to see a crowd. But just about all the time we've quoted that. Well, there's two or three that's gathered together in my name. There am I in the midst. There am I. And that's a blessing.
It's an occasion, yes, it is.
But still, we'd like to have the house full, wouldn't we? Hardly ever, Brother Ronnie, a lost man, on a business meeting. Once in a while, I see it. Hardly ever. It enthuses me. We like visitors, just like you. We like visitors here, we like visitors in front. Always glad to have you. But God fixed it to where that we need to be Christ-like. Yeah. And so many examples that we showed were one-on-one. Well, what is that? That's two that's gathered together. One of them may not be in the name of the Lord for just a few minutes. Might be. God knows what we need. Love each and every one. Want to go to heaven with you. It didn't mean to take that much time. Seems like I get in my way sometimes. I've said that before. Don't mean anything wrong about that. That's just the way I feel sometimes. There's nothing, anybody said it or not. Love each and every one. Don't want to go to heaven, Brother George, when life is over. And we can. Why?
Right.
Because Jesus said we're good. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. One of the commandments is, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. That's what causes me to get up even when I don't really feel that good and go ahead, Brother Dolphus, is because look how much he done, didn't finish reading all that there. A lot of suffering that went through.
Yeah.
But that iniquity right there, think about that. That we're all headed for a devil's hell, and that's what be pronounced unto us, that iniquity.
Yeah.
But by his power and his might, showing forth his love, taking care of our sins, we don't have to hear him say, depart from me, word of iniquity.
Amen.
But we can hear him say, enter thou in to the joys of the Lord.
Because
you've been faithful over a few things. Well, he didn't make enough words put down in books that would fill this church up or the whole world for us to try to figure out. But he simplified her down to two complete books, sir. Which means it's established, Brother Tommy. His word is forever established here upon this earth. Think about this. I'm talking about the heavenly part of it. Those that's on the outside, they just think it's another book, Brother Ron. All these days are going to be. All they're going to be, I'm telling you, they're going to face the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and they'll know it's all real and true. And I can't help but think that, Brother Tommy, right now, the people that even claim to be atheists, I can't help but think that there is none. Right now, they just claim to be. Because I never seen people fight against something that they don't believe in any stronger in my life than I do anymore. Now think about it. Why would you fight against something that you don't believe in?
Amen.
And why would it bother you that somebody else believed in it? It don't, ain't no little kids here. It don't bother me a bit for my little grandkids to believe in Santa Claus. Because I know he's not real. And I know they'll grow up and realize that for themselves, just like me. So why in the world would it bother anybody that I believe in Jesus Christ being the Son of God to a point they'd fight against us?
Yeah, yeah, they would.
That's a proof in itself, Brother Dolphus, that they believe, even by their mouth, the devil's telling a big lie and trying to get more and more people to say, don't believe in that. Why don't you come along with me and say, don't believe in that? It's simple to say, don't believe.
Yeah.
He'd be all right.
No atheists in the judgment.
No. He'll be all right here for a little while. But I'm telling you, in judgment, he ain't going to be all right. Because all them that don't believe, that they say that they don't believe on that judgment. Depart from me, thou worker of iniquity. Why? Satan and the devils, they believe and they tremble. They know that God is real, but they chose to believe a lie and be naked.
They got a part of God, and he breathed life.
Didn't say that. They didn't believe. They didn't believe it. Just like you said. That's what God did. Didn't say they didn't believe.
Something there tells them that.
They chose to believe a lie. Now that's what's going on with babies. Chose to believe a lie, and they're going to be naked. And on judgment, they're going to say, amen. My own condemnation. Think about that.
The word says,
now, some people that don't believe, and I'm glad that they ain't stepped over that extra step there, Brother Bruce. Some people that don't believe, they don't call themselves atheists, and they will actually say, when you talk with them, well, I believe. Just like I did when I was a sinner, man, I believe. That's good. That's a good start. That's something other than in the way. But except, as you all well know, except our people that's lost, believe from the heart that God is a rewarder unto them that believes. Not unbelief, brother, but believes. He will reward it. He has, hasn't he? Even in our sorrows and troubles, that we, as we get older, we're facing more and more of them. And that's just the way it's going to be until on that. But I'm telling you, ain't it good, Brother George, to have this hope that goes beyond anything in this world to know there's a brighter day coming? I believe everything God's told me, Brother George. He told me that I'm going to have a body like an unto him. He told me that if he don't come back before that this time here upon this earth is ended for me, that I will simply go to sleep. This creature is going to die, to go back to the dust in which it came, but this soul will never die. And to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, which is far better. Hey, when Paul said far better, he couldn't write about what made it far better. And when he looked into heaven and saw all those things, he told him, don't you write these things, Paul. Paul's a good writer. I believe he had revealed so much to us, we said, well, look here.
Yeah.
God knows how to do this, don't he? He wants us to come to this in faith, believing. Not no mathematical equations, not no scientific proof, but faith believing. He fixed it. The old man be a fool wayfarer man. He was not there, there he don't take great wisdom. He don't take no scientific figures, you know, and formulations, or mathematical figures and formulations. Think about that.
It's a broken heart.
I better rest. I've been getting so much on my mind. Me and my brother was studying about this the other day. About these these mathematical geniuses in this world. They've got formulations, and I don't know how in the world they've run. But I'm telling you, they figured out some very strange things. Let me just tell you this right here. And we was looking at that. Of course, they didn't say that, but they had all that out there, and me and my brother saw it. Those that are rich, we're talking about millionaires and above, they run a formulation on all of them, of everything, information they could get, all that they could. Thousands and thousands and thousands of them. And the number that comes out of that is 639. I don't know. You know, don't ask me how they got that. But they said it all ends up 639. Well, if you add 6 and 3 together, it went up to 9. Me and my brother saw that. Hey, happy people. Most of them got salvation. They run some mathematical equation on that. Guess what their number is? I don't know if this is true or not. I just read what we saw there. We was talking about it. 369. We're all people, ain't we? But 3 represents the great Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And for people that was happy, that was religious, it was first. Ain't that what we're supposed to do? Put God first and foremost in our lives?
Yeah.
We're part of this world. Man was made in that 6 days. We all exist together. You know? Mm-hmm. We're either going to serve God or we're going to serve man in this day. Yeah. And we're going to be judged according to the deeds done in this body in this day. In judgment. Mm-hmm. It's going on right now. But them fellas that put money in what is first and foremost? That 6, which represents these earthly things, God made man out of the dust of the earth in the 6th day, breathed the breath of life in him, became a living soul.
They put all this wealth in things. It's what me and my brother got out of this. I just want to share. They put it first and foremost. They put God on the back burner. Does that sound about right? They didn't mention that. None of that. It wasn't nothing about that. It was just mysterious to them that this year would come up the same way. They said the same way, just the numbers. It was turned. Remember, listen, God fixed all of this. God is a perfectionist with mathematics. It goes far above what we can understand, Brother Tommy. And he's fixed his stuff until people are starting to kind of unlock a few of these little things, coming out with little things that they don't even understand, that's showing to me God. And all these things. God particle. God. Why do they call it God particle? Because it seems like everything comes from it. And it holds everything together. Oh, it made some of them fellows madder than a bull when these fellows come up with that name. Called it God particle. They wanted to change it. Of course. That's the way the devil is. But God fixed all this. And he's holding it all together. And when you're looking at something other under a microscope and you're studying it, and it's holding everything together, and you remove that and everything flies apart. Anybody's got any sense? We'll say there's a beginning, and there's some power that's holding everything together. Huh? And when you remove it, what did God say in his word? One old writer said, if you draw back your breath and your power, all that's living will go back to dust. There's that God. That's the real God, brother. And I'm telling you, Brother Tommy, people better wake up because God got all of this and fixed all of this. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you that all these things that's being proved that they can't still see God, and they never will in this stuff, Brother Dale, because God means for us to find him in faith believing.
Amen.
And once we find him in faith believing, and then he will show us all these things that's going on, Brother James, that God, we knew that God already exists. He's all powerful. But it just points out to us plainer and plainer and plainer all the time, brother, that God is. May God bless you, Brother Hush.
Everybody stand, sing that song, What a Day That'll Be. Brother James, you'll start that for us. Everybody move around, fellowship. Church doors open. If there's one more ready, we always want to say that. Don't want to break up without giving in.
There is coming a day when no heartaches shall no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye, always peace forevermore. What a day of glorious
Anybody have anything on your mind before we come to a close?
It's the freeness, freedom that Christ gives.
Yeah.
That's to be cherished.
Yes, it is.
Now, I know I have went to places like that. There was a church asked me, a couple of deacons asked me to come preach about the organization of the church. He said he'd hear me preach on the Acts of the Apostles, how he wanted the church, said it wasn't what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
Kind of, I'm like Junior, it bothered me for 2 weeks at least. And I walked up there, and I said, I'm going to go early. And I knew they had Sunday school, I'm going to go see what. So I went in there about, supposed to be in there at 11, I went in about 10:30. And I walked up the steps like this, and I looked right there in the corner. The dedication to that church was January 1951. You know the reason I remember that? That church was organized the year and the month that I was born. And here we go back that many times about the directions that the Lord left on that. And I think about that often. Sometimes I like to go back just to the old basic stuff and stay right in there to what saved me 40 years ago. That broken heart, contrite spirit, repenting. I like to do that. I hope I always stay where sometimes they'll, as Brother Trevor says, ouch. You know, that's good. That's good. But you're free here, Brother Tommy. You got a
praise the Lord.
Beautiful, wonderful church here. It's good for me. It is great for me.
Glad you feel that way.
And Brother Gilbert Miner says if we could just afford to buy gas to get here. Well, I live 300 feet away, but it's good. You folks are always welcome up at our church.
If you ever get to where you don't have gas to come here, let me know. I'll give you money to come on.
Anything else?
Like I said, church at Rush Creek tomorrow night, 6:00 all year round. And then we'll have church, Lord's will. Time goes on Sunday morning, 10:30. And I'm Lord's willing. Be down in Philadelphia. That's my particular time. Just called me to make sure I was coming. So.
Revival starts next Sunday night at
Falls Chapel.
Yes.
That's mine too, 7 o'clock down through the week. They got different ones scheduled about each night, and different singers too. So keep that in your prayers and in mind as well.
Yes.
Anything else? Not? We'll ask you to bow your heads. And Brother Dale, pray this mission for us.
Give one bow. Good Lord and Heavenly Master, again we come to you, Lord, with a thankful heart. Thank you, dear Lord, for what we've heard here tonight. Thankful, dear God, for you being with us, Lord, and helping us, Lord, down through this little meeting. Lord, we thank you, dear God, for this meeting. Lord, we need you so much, Lord, in our lives. We need to feel your touch, Lord, every time we come through them doors, Lord. We seem like we feel it better tonight than we have for a while. We thank you, and we praise your sweet name, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all good and perfect gifts, Lord, come down from Father's life. Lord, we pray, dear God, that you'll dismiss us from this little place, Lord, but never from your presence, Lord. Help us, dear God, as we go, protect us. Help us, Father, we pray. In Jesus' name, I ask it all. Amen.